FX, what may have been NASCAR's longest night of qualifying ever, helped prepare us for NASCAR's longest race, the Coca-Cola 600, Sunday night. The big incident of qualifying, Dale Jarrett said something in the suspension bottom on his Robert Yates 88, and he went for this long slide. The crew was unloading the backup car before that one even came to rest. And Jarrett will start 37th Sunday night. The biggest surprise of last evening, rookie Ryan Newman in a Roger Penske Ford won the pole, displacing Jeff Gordon, the seven-time pole winner, to the outside of the front row. Rained out last night, NASCAR's Goody's Dash Series. And they are here today to run on the mile-and-a-half Lowe's Motor Speedway in the Tom Johnson Camping Center Easy Care 100. Let's get out of pit road and Dick Bergeron.
Well, usually when you come to a race like this, drivers are talking about the chances that they will have to win the event. Here, the drivers are more talking about their chances to finish the event. In practice alone, three drivers demolished their race cars. I mean, demolished them, absolutely wrecked them. And last year, in this event, almost a third of the field failed to finish, most from crashes. So while everybody wants to win, everybody is first focused on finishing this thing. This is Steve Burns.
But thanks, Dick. Let's talk a little bit about what you'll see, or more accurately, what you won't see. If you look on pit road here, behind pit road, there aren't many tires. That's because they probably won't even change tires. The pole sitter, Robert Huffman, said they can run about 35 laps. They'll come in, get some gas, and go. That is, if it stays green.
Thanks, Steve. Hello, everyone. Mike Joy with Larry McReynolds here at Lowe's Motor Speedway. Many of the Goody's Dash Series events are run on short tracks, but they get to run Daytona and they get to run here at Charlotte, and that's a great opportunity for these drivers, many of whom aspire to Busch Grand National and Winston Cup careers.
Well, it is. These guys, they run 18 races. This is their fourth race of the season, but I love this division. I mean, only about six or seven of these drivers do this for a living. Most of them have other jobs. They do it for a hobby. They don't race for a lot of money. They do it for pride and for hopefully the thrill of victory. But you're right, talking to a lot of these young guys, and a lot of them are young, a lot of them's goal is to someday hopefully be here on Saturday running in the Busch Grand National race, maybe one day Sunday in the Winston Cup race.
And as we'll find out shortly, there are some very close ties to Winston Cup teams in this field. It's the NASCAR Goody's Dash Series set to go here at Lowe's Motor Speedway on FX. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Charlotte, where NASCAR's Goody's Dash Series takes center stage today in the midst of Charlotte Summer Speed Week, culminating in the Coke 600 that you'll see on Fox Sunday night. But tomorrow, it's the NASCAR Busch Series, and that'll be on Fox. The CarQuest Auto Parts 300 at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, followed by NASCAR Winston Cup Final Practice right here on FX. Then Sunday, NASCAR This Morning on Fox Sports Net at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, and at 5 p.m. Eastern, the longest race in NASCAR, the Coke 600 on Fox. A big weekend of NASCAR here on the Fox family of networks. Let's go to pit road and Dick Bergeron.
21-year-old Shane Meal is one of the youngest drivers in today's race, but he's a good one. Last race for this series was in Darlington. He won it. Today he starts about mid-pack. What's the strategy?
We come with a little more downforce on our car, hoping that on long runs we're going to be better than the guys that brought their speedway cars. So that's our plan, to have a good, safe race and long green runs, and hopefully we can see what we can do at the end.
The downforce should help make it stick better. To Steve Burns.
Dick, Robert Huffman is a four-time series champion, but so far in 2001, he has not won yet. Today, he starts from the pole, and interestingly enough, in a Toyota. Robert, you've done well at this track. You've won races. How about today?
Well, I really enjoy racing here, and, you know, we have a good car here in the White House, Apple Juice Toyota, and hopefully we can bring this thing to victory lane.
All right, best of luck. Let's go back to Mike Joy.
Thanks, Steve. This will be the 16th appearance of the Goody's Dash Series at Lowe's Motor Speedway. They first raced here in May of 1975. We're set to go racing. Let's go trackside for the command.
Ladies and gentlemen, we direct your attention to the flag stand at this time, where we welcome our honorary starter, the Easy Care Vehicle Service Contracts Agent from the state of Louisiana, Perry Burney. Also, we welcome our Grand Marshal for today's race, the Chief Executive Officer of Tom Johnson's Camping Centers, Mr. Tom Johnson, for the most famous words in racing.
Drivers, start your engine!
So we're set to go racing for 100 miles here at Lowe's Motor Speedway north of Charlotte. Stay with us here on FX. Pace laps begin for the NASCAR Goody's Dash Series. To go 100 miles today at Charlotte as part of Summer Speed Week, here's the Castrol starting grid. Robert Huffman's Toyota on the pole with Danny Bagwell's Mercury. A pair of Pontiacs occupy the next row and the next row and the next.
Here is very interesting because that's what the strategy. These guys have a window from about lap 25 to about lap 40 that they need to get to pit road to get that fuel put in. Again, as Steve Burns mentioned, no tire change unless you have a problem. The real strategy.
The Wesson Cooking Oil, Peter Pan.
Is the car number 84 of BJ Mackey. He sits fifth in the championship points, but is elected to miss this event. And our thoughts and prayers are with his family as his father, Billy Butch Mackey, finally lost the battle with cancer on Tuesday and passed away. So again, our thoughts and prayers are with him and his family.
And we had one driver injured this week in a motorcycle accident. Broken pelvis is going to keep him out of today's race. Perry Wisnant, Wednesday night. Driver number 46, Gary Moore, replaces him.
You heard Tom Johnson, the Grand Marshal, say, driver, start your engine. Reason is, it's not gentlemen start your engines. We have two females in the field today, number 02 of Kelly Sutton and the 06 car of Angie Wilson.
One more pace lap and we'll be set to go. Import cars in NASCAR are nothing new. In the middle 50s, Al Keller won a NASCAR race driving a Jaguar, which was then legal in the Winston Cup division. That race was at Vineland, New Jersey. And there was a Volkswagen Bug.
All right.
In the field, the only time one has competed in Winston Cup racing. This division started out with four-cylinder cars. Some of the early cars were Mercury Capris, Ford Pintos, and the like. Now the Pontiac Sunfire body style predominates, along with a smattering of Toyota Celicas and Mercury Cougars.
And you know, again, there's only three four-cylinders in the field. Most everybody's running V6s, but NASCAR has done all they possibly can to try to even the horsepower up by giving them different weight breaks and all. For instance, if you're a four-cylinder, you can be 100 pounds lighter. V6. Also, if you've got a four-cylinder, you can run a bigger carburetor, and they give them a bigger restrictor plate, an inch and an eighth versus an inch and a... 16th on the V6s. These cars are weighed with the driver, so they weigh about 800 or 900 pounds less than a Winston Cup car.
Would you expect, Larry, the fours will be a little slower accelerating, but once they get up on boil, should be right there with the sixes.
Well, again, the big difference to me, knowing what I know about restrictor plates, a little bit's a lot, and that 16th difference in that restrictor plate, inch and a 16th versus inch and an eighth on a four-cylinder, that can make a big difference, but there's only three four-cylinders in the field.
We're set to go racing this time around at Lowe's Motor Speedway for 67 laps, 100 miles for the Goody Stash Series. Pace car is in, and we'll start without Scott Kraling of Naples, Florida, whose car number one has gone behind the wall. Green flag, and we're racing in Charlotte.
Takes these cars just a little bit to get wound up. Again, not near the horsepower we see with the Winston Cup cars, the Busch Grand National cars. Time they get back around to the start finish line, they'll be full speed though. Qualified at over 150 miles an hour, most of the front cars did. So that's pretty fast for a four-cylinder and a V6.
Oh, that's stout, Larry. When these cars first came here to Charlotte back in the mid-70s, about 130 miles an hour was a hot lap. Well, they've not broken formation at the front.
Two by two by two all the way through here. Looks like the 10 car of Danny Bagwell led the first lap. He was on the high side again. When you've got less horsepower running on the high side of the racetrack, you keep your momentum up better.
Five cars out front with just a little bit of distance. Not much. Robert Huffman there in second. The yellow Toyota. Challenge at third. Hopgood, Heltzhaus up there. At the front, will they have a chance to break away if they stay side by side right here for third?
Yeah, I would say these cars, a little bit of the draft will play a role here. You know, if they can get hooked up, I think it's going to take more than two cars to do it to break away. But once these guys get lined up, then you'll see them. I think, whoa, he gets real loose down there in the middle of the corner.
Whoa, and the leader gets squirreled up again coming to the line. It's Danny Bagwell with Robert Huffman in second. Kelly, Hopgood, and Miller.
See Huffman in that 37 car working that high side. He's got a runoff turn two. He wants to lead down the backstretch here.
Bagwell, 18th in points, finished 11th at Darlington, his best of the year. He has four career wins, and he surrenders the lead.
And he surrendered it big time. Huffman got such a runoff turn two down the backstretch. Now he's done pulled out to about a 4 or 5 car length lead. Spotter telling Robert Huffman, you kind of got his attention in so many ways.
That's still a pretty tight pack, Larry, from fourth on back, though.
Yes, it is. Guys are racing each other clean, though. Robert Huffman just driving away from these guys. But when you think about the current Goody's Dash Series, you think about Robert Huffman. He's four-time champion and has won the last three championships, 98, 99, and 2000. But his best finish this year is only a sixth at Daytona in the season opener.
For more on the leader, Dick Berggren.
Talking about Robert Huffman, a lot of people in the garage thinks this will be the day that the Toyota car breaks through and that Huffman will be the driver to do it. He surely knows how to race. Last year, of 1,849 laps in this series, Huffman led 893, 48%. He was second quick in the first practice, won the second practice, won the pole, and right now he is leading this event despite the fact that the Toyota engine under the hood of that car is about 33 cubic inches smaller than the engines in the other brands. But he's got the restrictor plate, and Huffman thinks that's a great equalizer.
That's what Larry thought at the top of the show. Big plate, big steam.
No substitute.
Robert Huffman. Our leader, Danny Bagwell, Kelly Hopgood, Britson Hopgood, and Miller, the top seven here at Lowe's Motor Speedway. Turn of Fox Saturday Baseball. Juan Gonzalez looks to continue his torrid start for the Indians against Derek Jeter and the world champion Yankees. Two National League powers collide when Gary Sheffield and the Dodgers battle Jeff Bagwell and the Astros. Or you'll see regional action. Watch the entire baseball season unfold across the Fox networks. Robert Huffman with a 1 second lead on Danny Bagwell here at Lowe's Motor Speedway in the Goody's Dash Series. And moving up, Shane Meal has come from 17th to 7th in that number 26.
Jimmy, watch Jimmy.
Keeps coming.
Yeah, he's got it groove up there on the high side of the racetrack, and he's a lot faster than these cars right in front of him. But he needs to be patient. You hear him telling him just to be patient. That's his dad, Steve Mill, who is the competition director for Dale Earnhardt Incorporated.
Heavy, heavy traffic.
Won the last Goody's Dash race run a few weeks ago at Darlington, and also his crew chief, when you think of Goody's Dash in the past, Dean Combs has 60 Goody's Dash wins.
Whoa, he got kicked way up high by the 61 of Cam Strader. That opened the door on the inside. Pretty tight battle right there. And here they come three wide through the quad oval and off to turn one. Hopgood up to the outside there. Meal looking in. First 16 cars are in pretty close contact here. Shane Meal looking them over. Moves up toward the high side on Hopgood. Battle for sixth place here.
There you see Cam Strader in that 16 car. Now, he started ninth. He's moved up to fourth. He's our points leader. And I had an interesting conversation with him yesterday. He's 21 years old. Barry Owens, who was a crew chief for Mike Wallace when Mike Wallace won some ARCA events and Busch Gardens National events, Barry is working with Cam on this program right here. And he said Cam is at that shop every single day working on that race car. If there's nothing to do on the race car, you'll see him out there cleaning the trailer or packing the wheel bearings. He said the kid wants to race.
That's great.
21 years old.
One win and a pole at Orange County so far this year. As he works to the outside of the zero, Derek Kelly from Lakeland, Florida, and is in heavy traffic once again, three wide. The 98 spent a while on pit road with the hood up, Steve.
Yeah, Mike, Roger Moser is still here. He started the 11th position, but the hood is up. Initially, they thought a plug wire had gone bad. Now they've taken off the air cleaner and looking in the area of the carburetor. So Roger Moser sitting dead in the water on pit road.
And last night, with all the rain we had, that's just what he would have been. That's when this race was originally scheduled, but fell victim to rain. So out front, Robert Huffman now by 2.3 seconds.
We'll say the whole field has fallen victim to Robert Huffman.
Yes. Derek Kelly leading that pack. Back at eighth place. And here's Huffman.
Just talking to all the crew chiefs, all these guys, they'd love to see a caution somewhere around lap 25. These fuel cells only hold 8 gallons of fuel versus a Winston Cup or Busch car that holds 22 gallons. And they are on a Goodyear bias tire, not a radial tire. But the tire run forever. You can almost leave here and go run them again at another racetrack.
Kind of surprising, Larry, these cars would get 6 to 6.5 miles a gallon. You'd think with these small engines, it might be higher, but of course they're running flat out here.
Yes, they are.
Hopgood and Strader. That's Jake Hopgood. He and Justin, the brothers from Winsboro, South Carolina. Their dad, Will, former winner in this division.
Oh, we got somebody, I believe, that's got a tire rub in it. Looked like Shane Mill. Shane Mill looks like he's
ruffled up that left front
there. Yeah, as he went in the corner, still seeing a trickle of smoke out of the back of that car.
I think he got a left rear tire rub, and it's not bad, Shane.
Heard Steve Mill telling him he thought it was a left rear rub.
back from straighter is number 16. That left front looks fine, but it's the left rear that's of concern.
As we listen to the in-car camera here to the audio, you hear the RPMs never change. Again, as you said, Mike, they're wide open. And that tire, it's rubbing pretty bad there. They certainly need a caution where they can get to pit road, not have to do it under green.
79, Danny Mathis goes a lap down to our race leader, Robert Huffman, who has a 2.4-second lead on Danny Bagwell and Cam Strader. Huffman smooth sailing, 2 seconds in front of Cam Strader. Now the second place car, but Strader under attack from Shane Meal. And let's get down to Meal's pit. Here's Dick.
Dean Coombe is his crew chief, and we're curious about the smoke that we were seeing. Is the car okay, Dean?
Yeah, the car's fine. We just had got a little tight over there, and I think he bumped somebody a little bit. The fender just had a little touch, but it's quit smoking now.
Okay, thank you.
Dean, a former champion of the division, guiding young Shane Meal's career. Strader in second. Meal right in his tailpipes. Now they have about 3 seconds back to Danny Bagwell, and Bagwell's leading a pack of 8 or 9 cars, fighting fiercely. There are the lap speeds, just about 150 miles an hour.
Not slowed down a whole lot from qualifying, only about 3 or 4 miles per hour.
No, there's nothing compact about how fast these cars are going around here. There's the all-time win list in this series. Dean Combs way on top. Larry Cottle, Robert Huffman, Mickey York, and Larry Hoopaw. 23 wins. Mickey York started this race in a borrowed car after crashing his own in practice, and that car has gone to the garage. Shane Meal, one of the rookie contenders, fourth in overall points, right now running third. The Darlington winner, as we mentioned, has 3 top 10s in all three races this year. A 10th at Daytona, a 9th at Orange County. Sunday, we'll start in twilight, end in darkness with the Coke 600, NASCAR's longest race, and you'll see it on Fox.
Here's the 11 car, Brandon Ward. He's made quite a move since the start of the race. Started 16th. He's moved up to 5th. His crew chief used to be Dean Combs. Dean Combs now helping Shane Meal. Now his crew chief is Steve Adams. But he's been on the move this entire race.
One of the many Pontiacs in this field. 20 years old. A lot of young talent in this division. 65 has pitted in front of Steve.
As Justin Hopgood won the season opener at Daytona, they thought they had a right flat right front tire, Mike, but they have just now shut the engine off. And you mentioned all-time winners in this series, their dad, Will Hopgood, 15 wins, and they're very dejected down here. Family affair for the Hopgoods.
Leaves his brother on the track, and brother Jake on the track, driving 61 in 5th place. Six laps to halfway, Robert Huffman with a 3.5-second lead. So we'll be back with more of the NASCAR Goody's Dash Series from Lowe's Motor Speedway north of Charlotte. You're watching NASCAR on FX. Good road here at Charlotte in the Tom Johnson Camping Center 100. Dick Bergman is there as Shane Meal comes to a stop.
Well, Shane Meal just burst out of the radio and said, I have a flat left front tire. Came, oh, and the caution comes out, and it's going to come out as Shane Meal is on pit road.
Kelly
badly
Sutton has
left
wrecked.
Front tire.
And Dick, I think that's the number 10 on its roof of Danny Bagwell, or with a long slide. Coming to rest at the end of the backstretch wall inside turn 3, there are 4 cars wrecked in all.
Wow. This all happened while Shane Meal was on pit road.
Kelly Sutton is one of those cars, and I believe that is Bagwell upside down. Check that. It is not the 10, it's the 0 of Derek Kelly, the Lakeland, Florida driver.
There you see him. He's, he He's crawling out the window there.
Kelly is okay. That's great news. But let's show you what happened coming off turn two.
Coming off turn two, looks like the car on the outside got into the 0-2 car of Kelly Sutton, and then this is just chain reaction down the backstretch. Wow, that car slid half the backstretch on its roof. That had to be a wild ride.
When you're going 150 miles an hour and things happen. Watch for the contact. Well, there's the secondary contact. The 44 goes spinning.
And he was just a victim. Yep. Kelly was just a victim down there on the low side trying to go around the wreck, and they got into him and got him up on his roof.
Doc Brewer went spinning and hit the inside wall. Now let's ride with Kelly Sutton and see how this started. 79 up high. Ouch.
Wow. Look like the 79 just come down and clip the 0-2 car.
This angle should show us right here. I'm not sure. I might give that 79 the benefit of holding his line.
Yeah, it was awfully close to call.
Looked like Kelly may have pushed up into that car. Whatever, the two cars ran out of racetrack, and there is the result. Pretty devastating for Derek Kelly's efforts. Fortunately, he is okay. So Danny Mathis in 79 and Kelly Sutton 0-2 getting together to kick it off. Doc Brewer was involved and Angie Wilson in 0-6.
Now we're on lap 31. Again, this is the window we talked about, and I think that's what had happened on Shane Mill. He got in that window. Steve, what's going on? Gas only?
Yeah, Jake Hogg was in, Larry. Gas only for the number 61 of Jake. Let's go to Dick Bergeron.
Robert Huffman is in for his stop. He was the first in. He is the first out. Mark Eckert got enough fuel in it. He hopes to go the distance.
The caution flag putting everyone on pit road. And we'll check when we come back, but we believe that Shane Meal was able to get back out of the pits without losing a lap due to that caution flag. So four cars pile up in the back straightaway. We're under yellow in Charlotte.
Good morning, Mr. Morrison.
Motor Speedway for an accident involving at least four cars on the back straightaway, and Derek Kelly ended up on his lid but crawled out okay. Robert Huffman, Cam Strader, Jake Hobgood, the leaders after pit stops. There is Kelly's car. Well, guess it's time for our Pep Boys trivia today. Who has the most Goody's Dash Series wins here at Lowe's Motor Speedway?
You always ask the hard questions when I'm up here without my partner in crime, DW.
Well, he has a son of the same name that has raced in this series.
Hobgood.
Close.
Mike Swain. Oh, okay.
Four wins. Speaking of Hobgoods, let's speak to Steve.
Hey, Mike, with Justin Hobgood, who's had a great season so far. He was first at Daytona, then sixth and fourth. What happened, Justin?
Right front hub broke. Like I said, we was just riding, biding our time, trying to save our tires, and pull a Shane Meal like he did at Darlington, more or less. You know, he rode and saved his stuff and come on there strong at the end. And right front hub just broke on the car going in one, and I felt the vibration. I figured we better park it before we tear it up. We're going to try to get back out there and ride, but best we can do.
Thanks, Justin. Thank you.
Doc Brewer on pit road and Shane Meal also in the pit lane after that backstretch incident that's put us under caution and sent several cars to the garage area. We'll be right back to Lowe's Motor Speedway. You're watching NASCAR on FX.
Car there of Danny Mathis. This is looking out the 0-2 of Kelly Sutton. Hard in the inside walls.
So set for the restart with Huffman's Toyota leading Strader in a Pontiac and Hobgood. Dick?
Well, Cam Strader has an interesting solution to his problem. When he first got here, he had brought a downforce car, a car that the aerodynamics push it down on the racetrack. That should help it handle a lot. But Strader said the car just didn't work all that well. So on Thursday night, after practicing all day, he hauled that car home, came back with a different car, the one he has here, which is an aerodynamically sleek car, the kind of car that you would run at Daytona. He put it in the field with just 10 laps of practice on it, and right now he's running in second spot. A bunch of guys got rid of their downforce cars for this race and went to sleek aerodynamic cars as we come to the green.
All three makes in the top three, with Toyota leading Mercury and Pontiac. Strader's in a Mercury in second place.
And that's interesting, but just like the Winston Cup cars at Daytona and Talladega, anywhere where you never back off the throttle, the slicker the car, the lower the drag, the better you're going to be. Of course, with the Winston Cup car here on Sunday night, a Busch Grand National car tomorrow, where you back off in the corners, you want more downforce. That'll allow you to carry more speed through the corners.
Lead lap cars string the top five positions together, and then a good battle behind them, but Huffman and Strader break away a bit.
Just remember that all these cars was able to pit within that window we talked about. Nobody changed tires. Tires of no importance, but everybody has enough fuel, should have enough fuel to go to the end from here.
37 of 67 laps complete.
Got 15 cars on the lead lap. Mr. Huffman has been picking them up and laying them down.
And again, he just has a little bit of edge each time down that back straightaway. Angie Wilson has come from the care center and joins us on headset after being involved in that crash. Angie, what happened?
To be honest, I really don't know. All I know is I was coming off of the turn two down there, and before I knew it, somebody got in the back of me, and before I knew it, it was all over, to be honest. Everyone seems to be shaken up, and I've yet to realize what's going on. Charlotte's not been good to us. This is our third year down here, and the third year we haven't finished, and I don't know why. It's an awful tough track, that's for sure.
Well, one top 10 in three shows this season. How was the car to that point?
Well, you know, we've not been fast all week, and I don't know why. I'm out there holding it wide open, and we're just not going. We've got some things wrong with the car, and hopefully we can find them and be ready for Kentucky.
Angie, this is Larry McReynolds with Fox. Just a curious question. We've been hearing a lot about this today. Some teams bringing what they call a downforce car here. Some teams bringing a low drag car. Which car did you elect to try to race here?
Well, we brought our short track car, which is the downforce car, and I think that that's really hardest, to be honest. We ran really good at Darlington with it. We finished sixth at Darlington, and I really think that that's hardest here. So last year we had our Speedway car, and we seemed to run a lot faster. So next year we'll probably end up bringing our Speedway car back, that's for sure.
All right, thanks, Angie. Glad you're okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Robert Huffman trying to edge away from this field. This is Johnny Chapman on board the Goody's Headache Powders on board camera in fourth place.
The cars behind him have pretty much elected to get lined up, and he's not stretching it out as he was earlier when everybody was side by side behind him. Right now he's about a half a second in front of this group right here. And you see that second, third place car, Strader and Hopgood, they're running that higher line, trying to keep these cars wound up on the high side, keep the RPMs up.
That curve's got a pretty good draft going here. Is that a big help here at Charlotte for these cars?
At these speeds, and again, the key is they're running wide open. They're never backing off. And when you're doing that, no different at Daytona, maybe not quite as much as Daytona, it's going to poke a hole in there and allow these cars to pull back.
Steve?
Johnny Chapman, the number 33 car, running in the fourth position. They think they have a right front tire going down, Mike. Johnny Chapman.
Ooh, fourth place car. As you ride along with him. Derek Kelly's been released from the infield care center after a long slide on his roof down the back straightaway. Derek, you okay?
Yes, sir. We're doing just fine.
What was it like up there when that car started to turn?
You know, we had a real good car. I hate it for Crenshaw Motorsports, Discount Auto Parts. You know, we're looking forward to a good run, our first time here at Lowe's Motor Speedway. But unfortunately, we ended up seeing Charlotte from a different view upside down.
Tough break for Derek to end up with that thing What's the sensation when that thing goes on its lid and you get to slide the whole length of the backstretch? What's it feel like?
Well, you're just hanging on and hoping that no other cars get into you. You know, I got to thank. We've had a great team here. This is the first time we've been here. Got shuffled back early on with some slow traffic there. And hey, I guess that's racing. We'll be back in Daytona.
Wish you better luck there.
Thank you.
But Derek Kelly, one of four cars knocked out of the race.
Laps to go. 25 laps to go.
In that back straightaway accident.
Saturday night shootout right here, buddy.
Huffman with a half a second lead. Just trying to pick it up just a little bit each lap. Larry, it's growing.
Well, this is interesting. We've watched Kelly Sutton come to pit road, and they've got the rear of the car jacked up. And at first, it looked like she was involved in that accident a while ago. It almost looked like they was going to change the two rear tires, but they've been working on the left rear an awfully long time. Again, these teams are not really in a position to make pit stops.
Yeah, that's where the damage was to her car, but she wants to get out there and get the track time, so they'll fix it if they can. Here's the battle from eighth place on back, and it's a good one. Tight pack of cars there. Three wide. We'll be right back to Lowe's Motor Speedway with the NASCAR Goody Stash Series. 7/10 of a second on Cam Strader and Jake Hopgood. Those two cars are 1 second ahead of Chapman, Britz, Nichols, and Ward. And then there's Britz and Nichols, 92 and 52. That's fifth and sixth place right there with Ward, the number 11, in seventh. Then it's a big gap back to a large pack led by Danny Bagwell from eighth place on. Brewer and Hell's House, 10th and 11th. Heights House, rather, in the 10th position, car number 18.
Car running on the high side has right here. 77 car, that's Wayne Edwards, going to get kicked back right here. Just you pinch the car off at the bottom of the racetrack and RPMs, it just bogs the car down.
That's one of those Toyotas that Edwards is driving. There, that 200 or 300 RPM would make that much difference here.
It really will. And again, when you're running wide open, what you're trying to accomplish is lose just as few RPMs in the corners you can. And how you do that is moving up the racetrack, making the racetrack bigger.
19 breaks through on the low side. Joey Miller from Wilmington picks up a spot. Moves up to 11. Let's check back with Steve Burns.
Hey, Mike, a couple of quick updates for you. The 02 Kelly Sutton was on pit road. Her crew said she flat spotted both rear tires when she was involved in that accident. And Johnny Chapman thought he had a flat tire cup going. The crew was up on the wall, but so far he hasn't pitted, so now they're not sure what the problem is.
I look back from his number 33. And the Goody's headache powder's on board Cam.
Johnny been in this series for a while. He's run a few Busch Grand National races, but he was the champion in 1991 in this series.
Robert Huffman trying to break the race record held by now Busch Grand National driver Christian Elder. And in good shape to do it if we stay caution free. For more on Chapman, Dick Bergren.
Well, there you're talking about Chapman's. Whoa, big trouble in the front straightaway.
Has lost a wheel, which catches up with it in the driver's door.
Wow, it's Tim Nichols.
From Cedar Bluff, Virginia, John Boy and Billy Pontiac. Either had a wheel come off or broke a hub, slid down the front straightaway. And it's a bad place for that tire to hit when it pounded the driver's door.
Yes, it is. It's going to just keep on going down pit road. Looks like it's going to go back out on the racetrack. Of course, caution is on the speedway. Here with about 17 laps to go, I don't think we'll see anybody come to pit road. They should all have enough fuel to go to the end, and they will not be changing tires.
hard to tell there. It looked like some of that hub and spindle might still have been attached.
Well, that would be the second or third hub that we've heard break today, and you just wonder maybe what's going on there. Again, a right front. All of the hubs take a tremendous load here in the corners at Charlotte.
We did see a portion of the hub there as that tire came and rolled to rest, so the lug nuts are still on, and part of that hub was still attached. So rescue crews moving to the aid of Tim Nichols. He is okay moving around in the car. Let's have a look at what happened.
This is coming off turn four right here. See him, the white car. His car, something's happened to his car right there. You get a feeling that possibly looked like it got loose with him. I think what broke the hub was the hard impact to the outside wall, possibly. Looked like the car got real loose. Yeah, he tore the left rear, right rear tire off. He just got loose back down in three and four, and that's the reason that it knocked the hub and the right rear wheel off.
Now, here's the hard part. Right here.
Wow.
Now, there's four horizontal bars in the side of that door, and they each have vertical bars connecting them and a lot of gussets.
See him getting loose, starting to try to correct it. Car just hard in the outside wall. And that's what knocked the right rear tire and hub off.
Driver out of the car and okay. Good news for Tim Nichols, who finished third at Daytona this year. Getting set for the restart after Tim Nichols' accident. He is okay, climbed from his car and was all right after hit banging the wall in turn four.
This is the hub off Justin Hobgoods. Now, this, of course, this is the brake rotor right here, and you see you got the lug studs, and I'm seeing also two of the lug studs that's actually broke right here. But this, of course, is the hub where the bearings are down in here, and it's just broke completely off the spindle. You've got the brake rotor, you've got the rotor hat, you've got the hub. The whole assembly is broken off the spindle. And it's a good thing that they caught that. That can make for a wild ride if it breaks out there in the middle of the corner.
Getting set for the restart. Robert Huffman is your leader. Cam Strader second. Jake Hobgood third. Johnny Chapman is fourth. Jimmy Britz from Jacksonville. He is running fifth. In sixth, the number 11, Brandon Ward. Now there's the hub that broke when Nichols hit the wall. What's left of it. You saw the wheel and everything take off with it.
We speculate no failure there. That's just hard impact to the outside wall. We got 13 laps to go. We got us a little shootout brewing here.
Now, Robert Huffman with that four-cylinder, can he accelerate as well as the B6s behind him? Well, let's see.
See Shane Mill in the 26 car, the fourth car on the inside. He's the first car that's a lap down. He's at 15th right now, but he's got three cars in front of him before he can go up there and try to get his lap back. But Robert Huffman's going to be tough to get a lap back from.
Yeah, those cars that restarted in front of Shane were also laps down. They don't make a distinction in the restart lineup between cars one lap down and cars more than a lap down.
These guys get a little bit racy now. We got a little short shootout here.
Cam Strader's the only car that was able to stay with Huffman on this restart. Looking from Strader ahead to the race leader. Hobgood in third. Fourth place car is Johnny Chapman. For more on Chapman, here's Dick.
Yeah, just before the Tim Nichols accident, Larry McReynolds was talking about Chapman in the Busch Series, and he was a good racer in that Busch Series, but he was pretty much self-financed. The thing that put him out, he took his best motor to the engine shop to be refreshed, and somebody stole it.
No.
That was the end of the line for him, and he wound up here in the Goody's Dash Series.
Wow.
To Steve Burns.
Dick, earlier today you talked about how good Robert Huffman is on this racetrack. He's won two Dash races here, and when they used to run the Sportsman division, Robert won four different times. He also qualified for his very first NASCAR Busch Series race here. Another reason he loves this track, said he gets to sleep in his own bed 45 miles from here in Claremont, North Carolina.
Well, they've ganged up on him, Larry. Ganged up in a single file draft trying to run him down.
Well, that's what it's going to take.
10th marathon back right here. Heights House in the 18, Edwards the 77, and the 9 of Ned Combs.
How many Combs is there? Everybody either works on them or drives them, Maiden Combs.
It's a big racing family up around North Wilkesboro. Second and third, staying tightened up single file, trying to run down the leader. No easy task here.
Jake Hopgood in that 61 car, I've been watching him. He really gets down into the middle of the corner good. He loses a little bit of ground here on the straightaway, it seems like. But let's watch him go through turn one and two right here. Right in there, it looks like we've just maybe a little bit better than the 16 car, straighter.
And you ride with Chapman. Didn't Chapman used to drive that apple juice car? And see, Johnny Appleseed, his real name was John Chapman, so there was kind of a tie-in there. 59 complete of 67. If this group's going to have anything for Robert Huffman, they better find it right about now.
Yes, they better. He just continues just to stretch it out. 3/4 of a second here, just 4 or 5 laps from the restart. We got this battle right here, though. This is for 8th, 9th, 10th, Bagwell, Miller. Combs is in there, the 9 car, Brewer. Quite a little battle. Of course, Shane Miller in 26, as we mentioned at the restart. He's a lap down in 15th. He's the first car. That's a lap down. We have 14 cars on the lead lap.
They're second place nose to tail, and meanwhile, Huffman is continuing to scoot away.
Now, I'm sure these cars act a little bit probably like Winston Cup cars. The 61 car of Hopgood, he's tucked right up behind Strader, and again, he's losing some of his front downforce. He can probably catch him, but the car don't turn as good because all the downforce and air has gone off the nose.
Let's meet Jake Hopgood's dad with Steve.
Will Hopgood, Will, Jake. Running that 61 car in third place, running out of laps. Can he get up to the front?
I don't know if he can get to 37. We hope we can get to 16. Said the car's a little bit loose, but Precision Engine Service Express Coat Pontiac running pretty good.
Thanks, Will.
So it's Toyota, Mercury, Pontiac. All three makes represented in the top three spots. Heights House 18 up the racetrack as Ned Combs in that light blue and white number 9 moves up. And that is for position, 9th place, behind the 19 of Miller. Joey Miller out of Wilmington.
'77 car there of Wayne Edwards started back in 24th position, and he's moved up to 11th, still on the lead lap, fighting with these guys for that 8th, 9th, 10th position. Got 5 laps to go, be 4 laps to go next time by.
Huffman's lead, 0.86 seconds. It seems he pads that by a couple of hundredths each time.
And with only 4 laps to go, he's got a pretty clean racetrack out in front of him, so I don't know that lap traffic will be much of an issue. The 02 car is out front running kind of slow, but he shouldn't have no problem as far as lap traffic.
Now Huffman's opened it up to a full second. Larry picked up more than a tenth that time.
It's like he goes as fast as he needs to go.
Eddie Flemke used to tell me that. I said, man, you caught that guy and passed him for the lead like he was.
Oh, we got a car spinning on the front straightaway. No caution. Looks like he's going to get down to pit road, so the racetrack will stay green.
Dan Shaver. And the leader just hit the wall in turn 3. Was it?
Yes, it was.
Could have been the 49 dropped something on the racetrack as it coasts in. But my goodness. Robert Huffman's number 37 piles into the third turn wall, 4 laps short of the checkered flag. That's pretty hard hit, Larry.
Yes, it was. Yes, it was.
Cam Strader inherits the lead. He and Jake Hopgood, if they can get this race back under green, will battle for the checker.
It's going to be awfully hard to get this race back under green because we're coming to 2 laps to go. So I don't know. We may be looking at the winner of the race right here, should he be able to complete two laps under caution.
Well, the 49 spun off turn four, Dan Shaver. Here's what happened to the leader.
Looks like he just got up high and it just got away from him. I don't know if he had a tire going down, but that's his high. We've not seen him run that high on the racetrack. No. It just like went straight into the wall, like maybe he had a right front tire going down.
All right, Larry, in this series, like most of the NASCAR Touring Series, they cannot end under caution. It'll be a green-white checker finish no matter how many laps, as you see the 49 of Dan Shaver go spinning. Now, that was off turn four. That was way away from where Huffman hit the wall at turn three.
So we will have us a two-lap shootout no matter how many laps of caution we run here.
Correct. Robert Huffman is okay. Four laps short of victory. His race ends at the turn three wall. It's never over till it's over. We'll be right back. Under caution at Charlotte, Cam Strader leading. He inherited the lead when Robert Huffman, who has led all but six laps today, piled into the turn three wall. Here's another look at it.
Routine right up to here, but right there, it's like the right front tire was going down. The car never turned straight into the outside wall.
Huffman was just four laps from the checkered flag. Dick Berger, and what's the indication of what happened?
Well, Huffman really doesn't know what happened, Mike. He keyed his radio and told the crew that he either hit oil or something broke in the car. He said that all of a sudden, just boom, he was in the wall. The driver doesn't know what happened.
The 49, which spun at turn four, Dan Shaver, then came down pit road. There was no fluid coming from Shaver's car, so.
And everybody else seemed to make it through there okay.
Yep. We're all in the dark as to what happened to keep Huffman from winning this race when clearly he dominated, opened up his lead from the last restart a little bit each lap to have a full second on the field. Getting set, though, for a green-white checker shootout. Cam Strader leading Jake Hopgood and Johnny Chapman.
And we notice no lap cars to the inside. Down finger restart, less than 10 laps to go. Only lead lap cars, which there is 13 of them to the front. No lap cars. Well, Cam Strader gets quite a jump here as the green flag comes out. And he's seeing exactly what he wants to see in his rearview mirror, a side-by-side battle between Hopgood and Chapman.
Chapman guns for second. And it's all happening deep in the rearview mirror of Cam Strader.
See, he's even moving his car a little bit down around on the back straightaway, trying if there is any sniff of a draft behind him, he wants to try to break that draft. We'll get the white flag this time. Strader with about a three-car length advantage.
So the point leader trying to come to victory here at Charlotte after inheriting the lead. The battle is back now for third. Jake Hopgood up high trying to hold off the 11 of Ward down low.
Battle behind him for fifth with 38 car of Sawyer and a 92 car of Britz. They're two by two all behind here.
Chapman's going to get close to the leader. Just a car length apart.
Got a good bite on the bottom of the race. Whoa! Whoa! We got two cars in the wall.
And we're going to have more.
They are coming to the checkered flag, though.
Strader will win it. Eight or nine cars go spinning on this final lap.
Got Shane Mill.
Oh, he tore the whole right side sheet metal off of his car.
They're still spinning.
The 9 of Ned Combs is involved. The 18 is all stove in, David Heitzhaus. And the 61 was one of the first cars to go. That was Jake Hopgood. And he was in sight of a third place finish. Steve Mill looking on. Shane is okay moving around in the car. There's Jake Hopgood. And there's one car further up track at the entrance to pit road that pounded the turn four wall. Our winner is Cam Strader. The 7 of Bobby Dayton is down on the inside of turn number four. He spun late. And there is still one car. Can't quite get a number on right at the entrance to pit road. Getting assistance for that driver.
This course through 3 and 4. See Hopgood, and I the car on the inside was starting to beat on one another, and of course just a chain reaction behind him. Nowhere for these cars to go. Almost the whole racetrack is blocked. Shane Mill hard into the Hobgood car right there. That's where all the damage come on Hobgood's car. Cars going down pit road.
There's the initial contact, Ward into Hobgood. 18 Heights House into the wall, the white car.
There were some hard impacts in that wreck.
You know, I think probably the hardest is that car that maybe Roger Sawyer from Orlando, way up at the top end of pit road inside of turn four. In real time. Pow! Sawyer.
Ward and Hobgood got together. Sawyer checked up, and the car behind him knocked him into the outside wall. And just again, the chain reaction behind everyone. And they're coming for the checkered flag.
Looking back from Chapman, which there it goes.
That's where the real problem started right there.
Out in front of all this, Cam Strader led Chapman to the line by 0.2 of a second. There's Cam Strader's crew. He maintains his point lead by 79 points. Dick Bergeron's in victory lane.
Okay, come on, Kim.
Cam Strader, last year's Goody's Dash Rookie of the Year, second win so far. You had a great restart with that shootout. How did you do that?
I tell you, we had an awesome car all day long. I don't think we had anything for Huffman, but we just had some luck come our way when he had that flat tire. And I knew we needed a good restart at the end to win this race, and luckily the Lord was with me, and he sent me sailing down the straightaway.
And you changed cars after your first practice session. Could you have won it in the other car?
I don't think so. I think we made the right choice today. This was a great time for Wesson and Peter Pan Peanut Butter to come here today and win their first race at Charlotte Speedway. And actually, this is our year anniversary with Wesson, and so it makes it that much more special for us.
Two wins, a second place on top of the points. You've got to be thinking championship.
I tell you, we couldn't ask for a better start to the season this year. I'm so excited for my guys and my crew that's worked so hard, and just everybody.
Congratulations to you. To Mike Joy.
Well, the point standing runner-up, Roger Sawyer, is the car that took the hard impact into the turn four wall. He is the point standing runner-up, and Roger has the wind knocked out of him and is nursing a sore arm as he climbs out. But that was a very hard hit. Good to see him get out of that car under his own power. We'll be back after this. Roger Sawyer, the point standing runner-up, goes into the ambulance. In addition to a sore arm, he also has soreness in his neck. So as a precaution, they've immobilized him and are going to load him up for transport. And that car, number 38, just took a ferocious hit into the turn four wall. Look at the right side of your screen. Or right in the middle.
Wow. You get a feeling because he's seen going on in front of him what was going on, that maybe he jumped on the brake, got the car loose, and it just, you know, couldn't control it. And it just keeps getting hit.
Well, let's go to the race runner-up. Here's Steve Burns.
Thanks, Mike, with Johnny Chapman. Now, Johnny, we heard you say that you thought you had a right front tire going flat. What happened? You're second.
Well, we were pretty fortunate. Good Lord looked after us today. We, after that one restart, I took off, and evidently something happened in the right front. I really don't know what happened. Maybe got against somebody, been a ball joint or something, and the car just started, it got tied all at once, and really tied off turn four, and really hurt us a lot. But we had a pretty good car, and I'd like to thank everybody for coming out, and Fox for putting it on TV mainly, and John Boy and Billy and Grill and Sauce, and Carolina Custom Carpenters, and it's just a really neat deal. And but getting back to the real question, I really don't know what happened with the right front, but the car did get tied all of a sudden, and I was careful there for a few laps and didn't want to have a misfortune hit the fence.
All right, well, great run, Johnny. Let's go back to Mike Joy.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Steve. Robert Huffman joins us. He had led all but six laps before pounding the wall there with three to go. And Robert, Larry McReynolds looked over your accident, said it kind of looked like a classic right front tire going down hello wall. What'd it feel like?
Well, best I could tell, the tire was still up on the car when I looked. I believe it was a classic, oil all over the racetrack, no caution for a car that had spun for about a lap earlier. You know, it's a shame. I tell you, the White House Apple Juice Toyota was a rocket tonight, and I'd just like to thank the Lord for Hans' device. Man, that thing hit a ton.
Were you on your normal line going into turn three?
Yes, I was. You know, I'd been getting in there pretty high and apex in the corner right there in the middle, and I swear there's oil all over the track up there, and I mean, I just couldn't turn it, you know. It hasn't been a good year for us, but we're going to turn it around.
Well, better days ahead. Glad you're okay.
Thank you.
There is the damage to Huffman's Toyota that took a hard hit into the turn three wall. We'll have more from Charlotte in a moment.
NASCAR on F.
Cam Strader puts Mercury in victory lane at Lowe's Motor Speedway over Johnny Chapman, Jimmy Britz, and Brandon Ward, who kicked off that last lap melee. Only nine cars finished on the lead lap. The accident cars included Jake Hobgood, then Sawyer, Heitzhouse, and Bagwell. I'll look back through the rest of the 38 cars that started today's race.
Yeah, and Robert Huffman, he leads 57 laps, but comes home in 28th. I know he's disappointed, not even a top five this season. You run like he run today, you will only win many races. Cam Strader, he didn't lead many laps, but he led enough, and he led the right ones.
Jake Hobgood was right in the midst of what was going to be a top four finish. And Jake, what happened coming off four there?
I'm really not sure. You know, we was running along there side by side with the 11 car, and I'm not sure if something broke on his car or my car took the air off his, and he just turned around, got up in the side of me, and turned me around, and it just started a big mess.
That's a pretty wild ride you took.
Yes, sir. It was a pretty good lick we took to the front end of the car, but, you know, it was just a bad ending to the day. We had a good run going, and, you know, the boardwalk, Billy's, Pontiac was really running strong today.
It was. It was a great run. Sorry it didn't end up in a great finish.
Well, thank you, sir.
Summer Speed Week rolls on at Lowe's Motor Speedway here. Saturday, the CarQuest Auto Parts 300 on Fox, and final practice for the Winston Cup cars here on FX. Sunday, NASCAR This Morning on Fox Sports Net and the Coke 600 on Fox at 5 p.m. Eastern Time. That was a wild one today, Larry.
Yes, it was. And again, the Busch Grand National race tomorrow. A guy that normally don't perform in the Busch Grand National, Dale Earnhardt Jr., will be driving for Joe Nemechek tomorrow.
All right. Another wild one coming up next. Die Hard on FX.